and Futera is here to help make the Anthropocene awesome. However, not everybody thinks that we're having an awesome time. This morning, we launched a piece of research called the Solution Survey in partnership with Ipsos, a survey in 27 countries of over 20,000 people. And we discovered that 1 in 5 young people are now fatalistic about our ability to solve climate change. 1 in 5. And that's all across the world. And honestly, I'm more afraid of fatalism than I am of climate science. But I'm also a sports fan. And so I know what it's like to back a team, even if you're not sure it's going to win, as many of you are. So what we're going to do in this session today is talk about the incredible power of sport to really make a change, both in terms of making sport sustainable and also making sustainability as powerful and engaging for humanity as sport. And to start that off, to get us in a sporty mood, we're going to do a Mexican wave. We're going to start here. Gonzalo, you're going to start. 3, 2, 1. Whoa! Woo, I'm back again. Whoa! Come on. Whoa! There we go. Come on, it's a sports panel, people. Well done. If you haven't done that at COP26 before, you now know you have. So to get us started, some people are going, whew. To get us started, I would love to invite a wonderful high-level champion, Gonzalo Moraz, who has been a fantastic and very passionate advocate for the power of sports in creating change. Gonzalo.
Thanks so much, Solidar, and thanks, of course, to the organizers. Let me first tell everyone that this is one of the last dreams that I needed to fulfill before ending my mandate next week. Honestly, because we understand the power of sport, the power of the so-called influencers, the athletes, people that are so admired all around the world, to really impact the changes and the minds and the hearts of so many people around the world. So proud to have you here, Nico, because you reflect that so well. Today is really, really a great day for the Race to Zero and for the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action. Because sports is joining the race by committing to reduce 50% emissions by 2030 and net zero by 2040. So I think that deserves a round of applause. Woo! We know climate change is like no opponent humanity has ever known. But we all know that if we don't deal with it, it will be the last opponent we ever know. So while the challenge may seem too difficult, it is one we must take on. And while climate change is not sport, we can nevertheless draw lessons from it. It's simple. The weather affects everything you do. Ability to organize and host games. It impacts the health and safety of the athletes. And let's be frank, it hampers the ability to make money. Sports does not only represent some of the most successful and influential businesses in the world, but also some of its most highly trained and talented athletes and billions of fans. People often think of sport as one side or one team against another, but the true power of sport is how they can unite people. They can take the best of each one and the best of the team. And they have a power that this lady refers to as the Scope X. They can really influence on how people behave. That power is a power that we need to strengthen in our future immediately. So just like athletes need a strong foundation to compete, at the very best, the planet is no different. We need the right conditions to maintain peak performance. For too long, we've treated the planet as if we're in a sprint, using all of our energy and resources in one short blast. We must understand that far from a sprint, we are together in the longest and most important of marathons, the race to zero emissions. In this marathon, despite some progress, the scientific consensus and the momentum at our backs is we are falling significantly behind. Like in sports, solving climate change will require commitment, energy, hard work, and collaboration between the players. What happens in sport when athletes come up against an opponent that they played over and over and just can't seem to beat? They come up with a better plan, a more ambitious plan. They analyze it properly. They take the best of it, better than the one they had before. They then work incredibly hard on that plan and work with others to implement it. The same approach we need to take when addressing climate change. And I congratulate you all today, the International Olympic Committee, FIFA, the Premier League, World Sailing, Envision Racing, Sky, BBC Sport, I would say also Real Betis, where we have two brilliant Chilean football players. Sport is through Sports for Climate Action today, staying true to its spirit. The strive to win, to be the best of the best, and to always improve and be better than predecessors and our previous selves. Competing in sport is also profoundly collaborative, working as a team and help each other to reach our goals. Today, we are all together in the race of our lives, a race that should move every single aspect of our lives, including what we watch on TV on Sunday or the type of sport that we do on this Saturday. The race against climate change, that is the most important race. It is a race that we have to win together. We welcome all of you to join hands with us to be the winners for climate action, because we need to win this race. Climate is a team sport, one based on radical collaboration. Thank you so much.
Gonzalo, thank you so much. Thank you so very much to Gonzalo. I'm now going to ask our wonderful team, Phil, at the back. Phil, would you mind running the video message from Gianna Infantino, the FIFA president, please?
Dear Executive Secretary, Ms. Patricia Espinosa, dear COP26 President-designate, Mr. Alok Sharma, dear Prince Albert of Monaco, dear Ms. Aisha Johansson, dear world leaders, dear delegates, dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the opportunity to share our plans to tackle climate change in the world of football. This is a critical moment. The change in weather patterns is impacting the environment and its rich biodiversity, food security, and access to fresh water, as well as the health and well-being of individuals. It is affecting the lives of entire communities and even threatens the existence of low-altitude countries and entire island nations. Football is not immune to the significant changes, and around the world, grassroots, recreational, amateur, and elite football are being affected. Following my election as FIFA president in 2016, FIFA became the first international sports organization to join the UNFCCC Climate Neutral Now campaign, pledging to measure, reduce, and compensate the greenhouse gas emissions associated with the FIFA World Cups. At the COP24 in Poland in 2018, FIFA became a founding signatory of the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action Framework. Many countries dream of staging a FIFA World Cup. Our new bidding requirements mean that those countries considered for hosting must ensure they have stringent, robust measures in place to prioritize sustainability. FIFA requires for all its members involved in hosting a FIFA World Cup or a FIFA Women's World Cup to follow key principles for sustainable event management and promote sustainable development in their country. Among the minimum standards we demand to include an environmental impact assessment, the sustainability of stadiums in terms of how they are designed, built and operated, and the reduction of and recycling of waste. Earlier this year, we published the carbon footprint of the FIFA World Cup 2022, and together with the Supreme Committee for Delivery and Legacy in Qatar, reconfirmed our joint pledge to make this next major tournament fully carbon neutral. We've also developed a green infrastructure standard for our member associations' football facilities, which are funded globally through the FIFA Forward Programme. This is about future-proofing. We've introduced requirements and criteria to ensure climate-friendly and climate-change-resilient buildings. On behalf of FIFA, I am proud to announce that, based on our long experience with climate action in football, FIFA has developed a comprehensive climate strategy and is committed to invest substantial resources that will allow FIFA and football to reach the ambitious and necessary objectives of the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action Framework, to reduce emissions by 50% by 2030 and reach net zero by 2040. The FIFA climate strategy lays out our plan to accelerate the delivery of solutions to protect our beautiful planet and our beautiful game. It aims to educate the global football workforce on climate-related impacts and climate-friendly solutions, adapt football regulations and activities to be more resilient to current and anticipated impacts of climate change, reduce the carbon emissions of FIFA and football to contribute to the Paris Agreement and the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action Framework objectives, invest in climate protection and support football stakeholders with access to know-how and funding to tackle the impacts of climate change. We must not stop. FIFA will continue to take climate action leadership by engaging actively and collectively with all stakeholders. So I'm delighted that FIFA Council member, Ms. Aisha Johansson, has agreed to attend on my behalf and share with you more information about our work to continue protecting the planet. I wish you all a very successful COP26 in Glasgow, as we firmly commit to playing our part in a more sustainable future. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you so very much. And we're going to hear from Ms. Aisha Johansson in just a moment. But first, I want to give a big sports fan welcome to an incredibly important person here at COP26. It's Ms. Patricia Epsinosa, the Executive Director of the UNFCCC. Let's show her what sports fans can do. Please do come and join us.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this very warm welcome. Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, athletes, I'm sure there are some athletes around here. Sports fans, many sports fans, I'm one of them. Welcome to everyone here to COP26. A few months ago, I watched some of the Olympics on television. As I was watching the winners receive their medals, I realized that while they may be standing on the podium alone, an entire team stood with them in spirit. I'm talking about the team that contributed to their success throughout their entire career, helping to train, to condition, to encourage the people who played a part in their ultimate success. We must look at our collective efforts to address climate change in a similar way. One person, one level of government, or one sector is not going to take us to the finish line. We need all people across all sectors and all walks of life doing their part. After all, we are not fighting for a medal, but for a chance to have a long future on this planet. The Paris Agreement represents our team strategy, one with a clear goal: to limit increase in temperature by the end of the century, preferably by 1.5 degrees. The sports sector can get us there. It's a sector that is important not just economically, but one that inspires every day and influences millions throughout the world. In October of 2017, I challenged this sector to work with UN climate change towards a common objective, to put the sport industry on track to achieve net zero emissions by 2050. I also invited them to become part of UN Climate Change's Sports for Climate Action framework, aimed at supporting and guiding sports actors in achieving global climate change goals. The sector accepted that challenge. 4 years later, more than 280 sports organizations have committed to the overarching objectives of aligning sports with the goals of the Paris Agreement. They range from the International Olympic Committee, FIFA, as we just saw, to Liverpool Football Club, Formula One, Athletics Kenya, the New York Yankees, Team Milesia, and many, many others. And the sector eagerly took up the challenge, but also told us that they want to do more and to do it faster. So those were exactly the kind of words, the kind of commitments we wanted to hear. So today in Glasgow, I am happy to unveil and launch the net zero targets put forward in the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action. The headline is that sports organizations are being challenged to reduce emissions 50% by 2030 at the latest and to achieve net zero emissions by 2040. By the way, this is more than what governments are being asked to do. Governments are currently being asked to be net zero by 2050. But we want sports to be the winners. That's a full decade ahead of what many sectors are working towards. And it is true to the nature of its work, the sector wants to set the pace for other sectors to follow. As we have seen, many have already taken up the challenge. But we urge all sports organizations to follow. UN Climate Change will be there to support you each step of the way. We can help amplify efforts and actions that you undertake to achieve greater impact, whether that's policy, publicity, or technology. In short, we can help you spread the good news. And by signing up to Sports for Climate Action targets, sports signatories join the race to zero. I know the climate champion has already talked about that in greater detail. Friends, I want to take this opportunity to thank the organizations who have already joined the Sports for Climate Action framework and have contributed so much already. Your ideas and your enthusiasm show your determination and why you are successful in your line of work. But let's keep it going. I ask you to help us continue building this great team to address climate change. Talk to other organizations and encourage them to join. Talk about your efforts and why it is important to you. Talk about climate change and how it will impact the health of athletes, or probably it's already impacting the health of athletes, whether games are held or canceled, and the jobs associated with all aspects of sports. Tell them it's about protecting the game on the field and the challenge outside the stadium, the fight against climate change we are all involved in. Thank you for your efforts. Thank you for taking up this exciting challenge and for the work that we will be doing together to achieve our collective goals. And please also help us inspire all your fans throughout the world. That will make definitely a huge difference. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ms. Espinosa, for those words. And how exciting to have the Sports for Climate Action targets now launched. We will hopefully see a significant impact that those make over the coming years. Thank you so very much. Now that that's launched, it gives me great pleasure to introduce His Serene Highness, Prince Albert II of Monaco, who is a fantastic ambassador for sport around the world, and also, to make sure I have the job title right, the Chair of Sustainability and the Legacy Commission at the International Olympic Committee. So, Your Highness, please join me. Thank you.
Much. Dear UNFCCC Executive Secretary, dear Patricia Espinosa, Mr. Gonzalo Munoz, distinguished delegates, participants, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I'm thrilled to have the opportunity to address you this afternoon. Among the many challenges of our fragile world today, one stands out, and we all know that is the climate crisis. Its outcome will have critical consequences for the future of our planet, and we must make this impact positive. As we all know, this crisis is a call to action for everyone, which includes the world of sport. As leader of the Olympic movement, the IOC has a responsibility to be part of the solution. We have a responsibility to be ambitious about leading the change in the sporting world because, as a recent sixth assessment report by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change made it very clear, we are in a race against time toward a climate-positive world. This is why the IOC is taking serious ambitions and serious actions across the three spheres of responsibility as a leader of the Olympic movement and the worldwide sport community, and as an organization and as the governing body of the Olympic Games. With regards to leading the change in the sport community, the IOC co-launched the UN Sports for Climate Action Framework in 2018 and has taken a leadership role in its implementation. The framework is important because it drives climate action across the sports world by requiring organizations to commit to concrete actions such as measuring, reducing, and reporting greenhouse gas emissions in line with the 1.5 degrees Celsius scenario enshrined in the Paris Agreement, and the IPCC has confirmed in its latest report, as we all know. The framework is how we bundle our efforts and show the collective ambition of the sports community on climate action. More than 270 sports organizations, large and small, around the world have signed up to it so far. Many of you present here today are signatories, and I would like to congratulate and thank all of you for expressing your commitment to climate action. The large number of signatories to the framework is a solid foundation on which to build on. However, it is only the start. We are in sport, and we know that we cannot rest on our laurels. We always have to aim higher. With decisive climate action more urgent than ever, I call on every sports organization to join the framework and to commit to meaningful action, as Patricia Espinosa has just done also. As an organization, our commitment to sustainability is illustrated by Olympic House. The IOC headquarters in Lausanne, as you, I hope you all know by now, is certified as one of the most sustainable buildings in the world. The IOC is already carbon neutral. It's a carbon neutral entity. We are committed to becoming climate positive as early as 2024. As announced by IOC President Thomas Bach, just recently, in light of the latest scientific evidence showing that climate change is intensifying, the IOC committed to a 50% reduction of its direct and indirect carbon emissions by 2030, in line with the Paris Agreement and the Sports for Climate Action Framework. It is key, and this is key, on how we will make a shift from a carbon neutral to a climate positive organization by 2024. Following this commitment, we urge all sports entities to follow suit. To achieve this ambitious goal, we are implementing reduction measures in relation to our business travel the energy use of our buildings and of our procurement. And we have an intermediate target of 30% reduction by 2024 to keep us on track. In addition, we will compensate more than 100% of our residual emissions, primarily through the creation of an Olympic forest as part of the Great Green Wall project in Africa to combat desertification in Africa's Sahel region. The primary aim of the project is to sequester carbon in trees and soils through the restoration of degraded forest and farmland areas. A diverse range of approximately 350,000 trees will be planted in Mali and Senegal, host of the Youth Olympic Games, Dakar 2026, over the period of 4 years, covering more than 2,000 hectares. The Olympic Forest is about more than just planting trees. The IOC will work with communities, and in particular women, to improve lives and livelihoods in 90 villages in the region by building local capacity to regenerate and sustainably manage forests and land. Accelerating the shift from carbon neutral to climate positive is also the ambition that we have set in regards to the IOC as the organization that is governing the Olympic Games. All upcoming editions of the Olympic Games have committed to be carbon neutral. From 2030 onwards, the IOC made it a requirement for all Olympic Games to be climate positive. In fact, the organizing committee of the Olympic Games Paris 2024 recently committed to achieving the first Olympic and Paralympic Games with a positive contribution to the climate before 2030 and to reduce their carbon emissions by 50%. As a leader of the Olympic movement, we call on other sports organizations to follow this lead in regards to their events and operations. In this, the IOC will continue to support international sports federations and national Olympic committees in their transition toward carbon neutrality and indeed to become climate positive. Collectively, we at the Olympic movement can make a difference that is felt far beyond the sports world. Few sectors have the inspirational power and the global appeal that sport does. This is why we welcome and support the Olympians' engagement in climate action. The Tokyo 2020 Athletes Call for Ambitious Climate Action, which gathers over 20 Olympians from 15 sports in over 40 countries, has a huge potential to drive engagement. And you will hear more about this later from Hannah Mills, Great Britain, double Olympic champion. I don't need to present her. But she's also the IOC Sustainability Ambassador. The inspirational power of sport gives us all the responsibility to use this power to inspire others to change behaviors for the better. This was also highlighted by the youth representatives who gathered in Milan at the Youth for Climate Summit, where they agreed on a manifesto which recognizes the unique role of athletes and sport to galvanize actions on climate. After all, the overarching mission of all of us at the Olympic Movement is to make the world a better place through sport. All the elements are in place to strengthen our efforts to combat climate change, to show purpose and urgency. The time is now to act. Having provided a high-level overview of the Olympic Movement's approach to climate change and the IOC's leadership role, we now invite other members of the sports community to share their climate action commitments. Thank you very much. I appreciate everything that is done here in this room today. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Your Highness. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, we've got off to a great start. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. And now I'm going to ask Miss Aisha Johansson. So you heard earlier from the FIFA president, but I'm very excited to introduce Miss Johansson because not only is she a FIFA council member, she was the first female FA president in Sierra Leone, and until recently, the first in the continent of Africa. So can we ask Miss Aisha Johansson to come and join us?
Thank you. So, dear Executive Secretary, Madam Patricia, in absence, and Prince Albert, Monaco, dear delegates, dear ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, first of all, I'd like to congratulate all of you. This is a superb platform. I'm extremely honored to be invited to talk to you today about climate change and football. As a FIFA Council member, for every step that we take into making global developments and changes in football globally, we always keep the planet or the protection of the planet in mind. Before we go further, I'd like to just share something which is personal. And that is that in this room and everywhere since this summit started, I think we're all together with one goal, one vision, one aim, and that is to protect our climate. That is to come together to see that all these devastations and all that we're hearing, it isn't just fiction, it is a reality. Now, I come from a country where we've had most beautiful country, I think, in the world, and certainly in Africa, Sierra Leone, tiny as it is, but it's an absolute paradise. Unfortunately, we have not been making pretty attractive headlines, you know, with the brutal civil war that we've had and the Ebola. And of course, now what I want to share with you is in 2017, the region mudslides, where over 1,000 people and children, including children, homes, were destroyed. And this was as a result of, one could say, there was corruption. One could say people were allowed to settle in areas where they shouldn't settle. Heavy rainfalls, the failure to protect our forest reserves and the mountains, soil erosion, everything that we're talking about today. And before then, I'll be honest in saying that, of course, like most people, heard about climate change and the potential, you know, devastations that it would cause. Didn't pay that much attention. Why? Because it wasn't at my doorstep. Mm. But in 2017, like I said, woke up one morning and 25 minutes away from where I stayed. It was horror. Daylight nightmare. Where children were off to school, people going about their daily business, and the mountains just opened. And within, I kid you not, 10 minutes, over 1,000 people dead, homes sunk. And it was like a movie. And from where I live, right at the top, you could see. I have a football team. It's a Premier League club now. I founded in 2004, and I didn't buy a Premier League club. These were actually kids that I took under my wings, you know, in the area community kids. They were orphaned added from the Civil War. And so it's a long story, but anyway, took them under my wings, educated them, and put them through the football sessions. And some of them have gone to Manchester City, Chelsea, et cetera, and that was how I came into football governance. Now, the point I'm trying to make is some of these kids, a lot of the kids that died that day, that went missing, they were actually playing football on one of the grounds that I scouted some of these boys 16 years ago. So it was actually, it's a very personal thing. To me, I know now that this is not just fantasy. It's not people wanting to make noise. This is a reality. And I am very happy that today, with what I see And I am also part of that change that we're not going to sit down and wait for it to happen at our doorsteps for us to pay attention and to know that we need to do something. And for those of you who have not experienced what we've experienced, well, thank God for that, and you pray for it not to happen, hence the rapid, intensive change that I see going on. Climate change and its impact is undoubtedly one of the most pressing challenges of our time, if not the most critical, and it requires each of us to take immediate and sustainable climate action. Last year, the FIFA president, Gianni Infantino, outlined 11 key goals for FIFA to make truly global in his vision 2020 to 2023. A game that is so powerful and popular around the planet cannot be played at the highest level in only a few regions. It has to be truly globalized, popularized, and democratized for the benefit of the entire world. In understanding the threats that climate change poses to making football truly global, President Infantino included firm commitments to protecting the environment and to harnessing the power of football to address the global challenges of the ongoing changes in Earth's physical environment. We recognize the huge importance of delivering sustainable competitions, and for many years, FIFA has been taking steps to measure, reduce, and offset its carbon footprint at the FIFA World Cups whilst working together with the tournament hosts and our partners to ensure that we meet international standards for environmental protection. FIFA was very proud to become the first international sports organization to join the UNFCCC Climate Neutral Now campaign. And we placed our biggest tournaments, the FIFA World Cup, at the heart of our pledge. We have worked tirelessly to measure, reduce, and compensate the greenhouse gas emissions created through the delivery of these mega events. I thank President Infantino for his earlier address to the COP26 summit, in which he referred to how earlier this year we published the carbon footprint of the FIFA World Cup 2020, together with the Supreme Committee for Delivery and Legacy in Qatar. We are committed to making the next major tournament fully carbon neutral. Our carbon offsetting portfolio will continue to be composed of verified emission reductions from projects across the world and the UN certified emission reductions from the Clean Development Mechanism. Next year's FIFA World Cup in Qatar will be another milestone for delivering mega events with sustainability at the core. From dismantlable stadiums to harnessing the power of technology for environmental benefit and greener transport solutions, this will be environmentally friendly. This will be an environmentally friendly competition. All stadiums have been delivered to the benchmark set by the Global Sustainability Assessment System for Sustainable Buildings. The Ahmed bin Ali Stadium was built by recycling 90% of materials from the previous stadium on the same site, while surrounding trees and vegetation were retained and replanted. The Ras Abu Aboud Stadium is the first fully dismantlable stadium in the history of the FIFA World Cup. After the World Cup, the stadium will be completely dismantled with the parts used to build sporting facilities in Qatar and abroad. But even all of this is still not enough. It's not enough for FIFA. For at this critical moment in time, we need to accelerate and intensify climate action. And as the FIFA president announced today, FIFA has developed a comprehensive climate strategy which continues to put our intention into action. FIFA is resolutely committed to investing substantial resources towards helping FIFA and football reach the ambitious yet thoroughly necessary objectives and principles of the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action. These being to reduce emissions by 50% by 2030 and to reach net zero by 2040. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to do more. This is not the first time, or we're not just starting now. In 2016, FIFA was one of the first of the sporting institutions, establishments, to team up with the UN, with the UNFCCC. Football has the power to radically shift mindsets on climate change and mainstream climate action. And these are the reasons why we urge our stakeholders, particularly our football fans, who are our major stakeholders, to join us in working towards changing the mindset and seeing what it is that we can do together as a team. More than 3.5 billion people watched the World Cup in Russia in 2018, and with 1.1 billion tuning in to watch the women's football in France in 2019. We have a huge, a massive, attentive and receptive audience. And with this audience and this platform, we can send, we can amplify key messages that will help to educate fans on climate change and encourage them to play their part in protecting the planet and this beautiful game. There isn't much more that I can say than what has already been said by FIFA President Infantino. But what I would like to add is we are all players in this massive big stage. One of my favorite authors is Shakespeare, all the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players. And that is what I see FIFA, and that is what I see all of you, and that is what I see the whole world is one big stage. The planet is who and what we want to protect, not just for us. I heard the Queen mention also, it isn't for us because most of us will be dead gone by then. It's for our children and our children's children. FIFA is committed to continuing to do more work with your organizations, with all other organizations, and like I just mentioned, with our partners. You only have to look at when Ebola hits. We had our stars that came on board to amplify the messages for Ebola, to help the FIFA for 11 fight against Ebola. They were there, FIFA for Health. So all I can say is good luck. We are with you, always with you, for the beautiful game and for our beautiful planet. May God protect us all. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, please thank Ms. Johansson for a very powerful address. And thank you so much for bringing your personal experience of climate change and of being a Premier League owner. We don't have many of those in the room. However, we do have a fantastic panel here in the room. I see some people videoing. I'm not going to make you do another wave just yet. I'll tell you when we're prepared for that at the end. I'm now going to ask Sylvia Filippi, Dale Vince, Nico Rosberg, and Katarina Nash to come and join me up on the stage. Please come and join me. Don't be shy, come along this end. So I've got you all.
Thank you. We're there?
Katarina's struggling to dial in, but we're working.
We'll come to Katarina if we're able. So come on, gentlemen, come down this end. We don't need too much, please. Hello. We don't need too much social distance. So that was a very powerful morning. Thank you very much for such a wonderful introduction, and particularly to the Sports for Climate Action New Targets. So we've got a little bit of time now, and I'd like to come first, Sylvia, to you, the team principal of Envisaging Racing. Now, many of us have watched these powerful races. We've thrilled to the splash, to the energy that's being shown. But what did it take? What investment did it take for such a huge undertaking with such a huge circus around it to become net zero?
Sure. First, hi everyone. Great to be here. Great pleasure. It was a big undertaking. But if you go back to the roots and purpose of Formula E, right? We are here as a sport. We are a young sport, 7 years old. But we're here to do two things, really. To accelerate the innovation around electric vehicle technology and to accelerate the adoption and the awareness around electric vehicles. So based on this purpose and being a sport property, we have to lead by example. So we don't really have a choice the way I see it. We have to operate at the highest level. So my team in particular, Envision Racing, we are already fully carbon neutral at the highest level, I believe, the past 2060. I fully appreciate that we are one team as part of a sport, so it's easier, relatively easier to do when you're a relatively small company, but we want to show that it can be done and lead the way for others to do it. So for sure it takes a lot of resource, a lot of time, a very strong understanding of your own business. It's a very forensic audit that you have to do. but it's for the right reasons. And I believe very soon the pressure, the global pressure, which is a really good thing, will kind of force everyone to do it anyway.
Brilliant. I'm going to come to Nico Rosberg. So Nico, many of us have watched UACE. And what I'd like to ask you is, what's the role for athletes such as yourself? We're used to seeing you in one role, and now here you are in another. What role can athletes take in really trying to drive this change towards net zero?
Well, it's very simple. I mean, as an athlete, you have a reach which is like absolutely unbelievably large. And I think it is our duty to leverage that and, first of all, be a role model. So in everything that we're doing. And then secondly, of course, ask the followers to join into the movement, you know, and you don't have to do it all day, every day. But if you make it a part of what you're doing on social media, I think it can be really, really powerful. And this is what I am trying to do as well in my own capacity. So just last week, actually, I visited in Sardinia. We're racing there with our electric racing series. And I visited the forest fire area, 20,000 hectares gone, families lost everything. So I was up there, first of all, supporting the local families with donations that we were raising, but then also, of course, raising awareness for what's happening there, you know. And from what I saw from the locals there, they were so appreciative, and that meant a lot to me. And that also showed me that it's the right direction to go.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. So Dale, if I can come to you for a question. So whenever anyone asks me who do I support, I always say Forest Green Rovers, because every other football fan isn't allowed to disagree with supporting Forest Green Rovers. So what role does Forest Green Rovers and sort of football with purpose have in telling this story?
I give the same answer when people ask me which club I support as well. So we've got that in common. I think it's been said before, sport has an amazing platform. You know, it has an opportunity to reach people. It already reaches people. And the opportunity here is to reach people with a different message, to inform them about the climate crisis and show them what they can do themselves to be a part of tackling it. You know, there are billions of sports fans on the planet. Doesn't matter what sport you're a fan of, you're passionate about it. And my view is that if we can reach sports fans through their favorite sport and make them fans of the environment, then we can achieve a great deal.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Dale. Oh, I got a clap for that one. So I see that Katarina has joined us. Hello. If I'm not sure where I should be looking to see you. Hello.
Hello.
Katarina from the UCI. Katarina, do you believe that pro cycling, when we watch this extraordinary professional cycling races, can that, when we watch it, we always think, I must go and get on my bicycle more. And then sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. Do you think that seeing elite athletes perform in sustainable ways of travel can encourage all of us to change our ways of traveling?
Absolutely. I think we have the right to, which is a bicycle. And the cycling industry has innovated tremendously since the time we all rode a bicycle as kids. We have essentially bike for everybody now, whether it's an e-bike, whether it's a cargo bike, whether it's a pedal bike. We just need to make sure that everybody gets back on the bike. People that don't have access to a bicycle will get a bike through some of our programs. And we also need to create safe places to ride bicycles, which is safe cycling cities. And finally, we really need help changing the drivers' perceptions of cyclists out on the road. So we've got a lot of steps to do, but we have the right tool. And if we can get everybody back on the bike, let's say once a week, once a month, skip the car ride, we are going to be in a much better place.
As a passionate cyclist myself, yes, please do change the driver's relationship to us.
Since we're on the topic of cycling, so at the Dutch Grand Prix this year, where I attended, I came into the track on Sunday morning, and there was, and afterwards I found out, there was close to 50,000 bicycles there. And not only that, but a lot of the large majority of the fans use public transport. So up close to 80% of the fans that came to the Dutch Grand Prix either used bicycle or public transport. So that was really a demonstration of how a sporting event can really make giant strides in becoming more CO2 neutral. And I know there's been some football football games as well that have tried to do similar. So even Formula One in that sense has been making great progress. And what I loved also was how proud the people were locally, because they knew they were a part of this trailblazing Formula One event that was the most sustainable event ever in history.
And Nico, quick word, what advice as a professional driver do you have to drivers on how to treat cyclists on the road?
Yeah, so I was a road cyclist myself and I got a lot of angry car drivers there, but what advice? I don't have any advice.
Give us the space.
That's not going to change it.
Siva, I'm going to come to you. So we've heard from FIFA and we've heard from the IOC around sports for net zero. But this is a competitive industry, competitive within each sport and actually competitive between sports, for money, for sponsorship, for audience. What role is there in collaboration when in fact we're used to competition?
Yeah, I think it's a very good question. I think we'd really much differentiate the on-track action and the off-track action. So ultimately, sport is so powerful, and I'm especially passionate around motorsport and electric motorsport because of the technology and the reach. It's only so powerful because we build these really gigantic platforms. But these platforms cannot be created by only one team or one promoter without the teams. So what you see is that, of course, the action, whether it's Formula One, Formula E, or any other sport, is really fierce on track, which is a good thing because that's what drives the innovation and the R&D. Off track, we all work together, more or less, depending on the circumstances, to make sure that we grow the platform that we're in. And that ultimately increases the reach of the sport and ultimately increases the influence that we can have. And assuming we're here to show a positive influence to the planet, then it's a good thing.
Thank you. Dale, what role for leadership and for ownership within a sector which actually is very led by, and we constantly follow not only the sports people themselves, but also the ownership of sports teams. What role for leadership and ownership in this move to net zero?
Oh, I think it's essential, actually, because to get the scale of change that we need, particularly at elite clubs where the opportunities for influence is bigger and let's say perhaps the interest in business as usual is also bigger, to get the change we need at that level, we need a change in leadership and ownership attitudes. You know, we need the environment built in to the DNA of sports clubs, not bolted on like a CSR package after the event. You know, a great example, you know, I don't want to kind of point the finger at them too badly, but Manchester United recently, they have an environment program. They like to talk about it. Recently, they flew for 10 minutes to get to a football game to play Leicester City, which is, you know, a shocking disconnect between their environment aims and the way we all need to be behaving, but particularly in terms of leadership, because, you know, Manchester United are a very popular football club, possibly the most popular in the world. And that sets a terrible example. So I think it's so important that leaders and owners embrace this completely.
Brilliant. Thank you. That's a powerful call. I'm going to come to you, Katerina, for the final question, which is what changes have you seen so far? We're talking a lot about the targets we want to set on in the future, but have we come a long way?
I think we all need to do a better job, starting, you know, from our personal habits to obviously our international federation. The ideas are there. We started the steps. We are working closely together and learning from each other, but it is going to take tremendous effort to work with the event promoters that are willing to put on environmentally safe events with minimum base. Changing our teams and their structure of support cars and looking at all the possible ways we can improve an environment, because us as athletes, we spend so much time outdoors. We really, really value the environment. And we believe that all the recreational cyclists out there feel the same, and we have to come together and protect this beautiful planet. So the steps are there, but we all need to get back on the bike, start thinking about how we can skip occasional drive or flight, adjust our habits, and start today, start right now.
Brilliant, thank you so very much. And I love that as our final comment, which is to get back on the bike. So please join me in thanking Sylvia, in thanking Nico, in thanking Dale, and thanking Katerina.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much. Thank you. Thank you. We now have another panel. In fact, an extra chair has been brought on the stage. So can I please ask and welcome Hannah Meal, the double Olympic sailing champion, Barbara Slater, the BBC sports director, Ledley King, an ambassador for Tottenham Hotspur, Inga Ruel, in fact, I just said I was a Forest Green Rovers fan, I should say Tottenham, Inga Ruel, executive director of production services and operations at Sky, and Cammie Krista, one of the Youth for Climate representatives, are joining us, and I believe one of her colleagues will be joining us as well. So please come on up. Thank you so very much. So thank you very much for joining us. It feels like you're a long way away down there, so I'm going to shout and introduce you. So we're going to run through some questions really quickly, and actually I'm going to start with you, Hannah. Like, such an inspiration to so many of us. What have you done? How are you using that ability to create inspiration for climate action?
I think athletes have a really unique position in this whole thing, because we have the opportunity to reach so many different stakeholders in the climate fight and the climate crisis fight. You know, obviously we've spoken about fans and people that support sports people, but also we can reach our sponsors. We can reach the massive sporting events that we are competing for. And so I think there's just this huge opportunity for athletes to have a really powerful voice in this whole topic. I kind of started my sustainability journey in the build-up to the Rio 2016 Olympics. And I think what I saw there regarding the plastic pollution and how bad that was getting was kind of my gateway into sustainability, and now obviously climate change as well as plastics. But I think it's really important that everybody sort of engages with this topic. But I think having that moment of really awakening to the problem is really important. And I think as sports people and athletes, we can share that with our followers and we can share that with our fans and hopefully engage people in that way.
Brilliant, thank you so much. And I think many of us who have seen what you've been able to achieve are very inspired that perhaps we could follow and achieve something similar in a small way for climate change. So Barbara, I'm going to come to you. The BBC, the huge reach and the huge reach of sport, what role is there for sport to tell the sustainability story?
Indeed, and I think we've heard very eloquently today a number of people express the power of sport. And what we shouldn't forget, I think, is when we have these big global events, for the vast majority of the audience, they experience that through the broadcaster's lens. And so I think we can look at this from a number of different angles. This is something that our audiences care about deeply. And I think one of the roles of the broadcaster is to bring this into the conversation, the debate, the surround sound that we have at those major events. Because I think we can help educate our audience and we can help inspire our audience. We've already heard, Hannah, you're a fantastic example of how we can tell your story within those broadcasts. I think broadcasters also have to lead by example. And I think we have seen, particularly through the COVID crisis, an extraordinary development of technology that has allowed us to do remote production. So, for example, if we go back to the FIFA World Cup from Russia, and we look at the European Championships, very similar events in scale and complexity of broadcast, actually, we halved the greenhouse gas emissions through remote working. So I think that there is a question of leading by example, but I think it is that power and reach. If you think of events like Wimbledon, the World Cup, the Euros, and their ability to reach millions and millions of people and all demographics, then I think the broadcaster has a very powerful role in its event coverage and in its journalism. I think increasingly we are seeing broadcasters starting to hold organisations to account. And I think that's another very important role for broadcasters in this space.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Bob. I very much agree. Let's come to Ledley. So tell us about how Spurs is winning on sustainability.
Well, you know, as I sit here and kind of say that we're proud to be the greenest Premier League club at the moment. And, you know, if I go back 10 years ago, or almost 10 years ago when I retired, there wasn't too much information that we knew as players. It was only later on that year that they moved to the new training ground, and it was a big shift, a big change. Today you go into the training ground, you see bug hotels, bat houses, wildlife ponds, you see a kitchen garden, which grows fruit and veg, which the players eat, which obviously reduces food miles. You know, it's something that all the players are really taking on board now. You go to the new stadium, 100, well, it's been used by recycled materials. You know, the food within the stadium is vegan options now for fans. And recently we've had a Game Zero, which was a huge success, I believe. We encouraged the fans to cycle, to walk to the stadium, to think about what they was eating on the match day. And, you know, we're just trying to raise the awareness, really, and engage our fan base into trying to do what's right to protect the planet.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Going to Inga from Sky. So we've talked about both the footprint of production and the footprint of sports, which is often much larger than people realise. They're not seeing all of the diesel generators backstage, etc. But we've also talked about the brain print, about the storytelling, about the passion and the billions of people that sports can reach. Can you talk a little bit to us about both? Sort of how is Scam managing both that footprint as well as telling the brain print story?
Okay, thank you. I think it's quite similar to Barbara's perspective as well. I think as a broadcaster, we tell the stories, the athletes, the stories of the athletes, the stories of the clubs, and we kind of add that storytelling element to it, which obviously has the most impact we can have in this space. But I think we felt really strongly from a Sky Sports perspective that before that we really have to clean up our own house. So we've been working on this for years now and really like educating all of our staff, changing our production methods, really eliminating everything we're doing on carbon emissions. And I think the really amazing effect of that has also been is that our creatives, our storytellers, the people who kind of, the producers, they've been part of that journey off screen. And then it makes it much more authentic when they're telling the story on screen because they've actually had to change how they produce. They're not traveling all to the games anymore. Lots of them are sitting back at base because we're doing it remotely. So I'm not going to bore you with all the production methods, but I think technology has been our friend. COVID has actually accelerated a lot of it. I think we've been doing it for years. So I think off screen, we're definitely getting our house in order, and we've worked with Spurs obviously on the Game Zero. And I think what the interesting thing from a production perspective was we didn't actually have to change much what we had to do because we were already doing it, and we've reduced our emissions by like 70% to like 2 or 3 years earlier on our Premier League production. This is off screen. And then on screen, we have this amazing opportunity to tell the story to people who are not necessarily as engaged as we all think. I'm always amazed when you go to a Tesco superstore and you just go, oh my God, the plastic. Or you go to a football match and you just, so it's an audience that not necessarily as converted as we'd like them to be. And I think, so we have this audience. So what we really try to do in Sky Sports is to still make sure that it's an authentic story we tell, but really highlight the stories that are happening, whether it's the disasters or it's the positive stories, and really kind of give that space to tell the story and not just in documentaries around it, but within the sports coverage when you have the captive audience. And I think what was interesting, for example, on the Game Zero was like it's inspired other clubs. So Norwich just kind of did it last weekend and we kind of did the big story around it. And I think it's that kind of impact you can have, the clubs can have. But I think we work really well together. But I think the particular bit that the broadcaster has is we're telling the stories and we're reaching not just the fans who come to the games, but we're reaching the fans who are sitting at home.
Very much so. Thank you so very much. I'm going to come to our youth delegates now. So at the beginning, I spoke about this new survey, the solution survey, showing that 1 in 5 young people are now fatalistic about our ability. And that's across the world. And you're more likely to be fatalistic if you've had access to lower income and access to lower education. And the message of the solutions are not necessarily reaching everybody. Sport has this incredible power to reach, this incredible brain print. What would you call upon the leaders of sport that are here and which are online in terms of what are your asks of what as an industry we should be doing?
Thank you for that question. And I want to briefly just introduce Rain, who's here with me from Youth for Climate. I think one key topic there's plenty of fantastic topics that have been highlighted around education, circular economy, circular usage, especially around venue constructions. That was also mentioned by FIFA. However, one topic that has not been discussed is that of cultural heritage, and that a lot of these sports rely on very fragile ecosystems to work and to be practiced. I personally was a ski racer during school. I come from Austria, and that relies on an extremely fragile alpine ecosystem. And the effects of practicing that sport obviously also are detrimental to that alpine ecosystem, especially when we talk about racing, in ski racing. And so one of the things to consider is what is the impact also on the cultural heritage of these ecosystems, as well as the cultural heritage of the indigenous and cultural communities, the ethnic communities living there. And for that, I wanted to also bring Rain on board because I think he should be representing the coastal ecosystems and the coastal communities here as well. So I want to hand over to Rain on this point.
You know, for us living in coastal, island, or indigenous communities, sports are, they're not just recreation. They are the embodiments, they are the preservation, they are the promotion of culture. And so when we talk about the destruction of the environment, we're also talking about the destruction of culture, and they're inextricably linked. So, you know, I grew up in South Florida, I live in Hawaii. The ocean is absolutely critical to our well-being, to cultural preservation. You know, I'd like to highlight the recent win of Carissa Moore, the first woman to win a gold medal, but also a Native Hawaiian woman. And continuing the legacy of arguably probably the greatest water sportsman who's ever lived, Duke Kahana Moku, who is also a Native Hawaiian and also an ambassador of Aloha. And so we have to also understand that, you know, going to Aisha's point, there is the concept of preserving future generations, of preserving culture through sport that have to be front and center when we're talking about the environment. Again, for us, 1.5 degrees is not a suggestion. Anything above it is simply a death sentence.
Brilliant. Thank you so very much. I'm going to come back to you in a moment, but I want to come to Hannah. And Hannah, I've got another question for you, which is, there may be other athletes watching, athletes earlier in their career, athletes who are passionate about these issues, but don't know how to tell the story of sustainability. What advice would you give to any other athlete who really wants to make a difference in the world as well as a difference in their sport?
Yeah, I think for anyone, not just athletes, there's so many ways to get involved in this conversation. And I think none of us can carry on being spectators in this global climate fight. So, you know, I urge everyone to take up that mantle and start engaging in the conversation. But I think for me, obviously, it was through what I witnessed myself and then educating myself through resources online, you know, working with other organizations that are already out there, already doing good work, that are always looking for ambassadors and people to advocate for what they're doing. I think that's a really powerful way athletes can engage in this space. And just start small, you know, start learning yourself and start posting on your social media around things that you find really interesting and take people on that journey with you. You don't have to be perfect. You know, we are all hypocrites in this conversation because we all have a carbon footprint and we're all trying to do our best to improve that and be better every single day. And so take people on that journey of learning with you, and your followers will come on that journey with you. And I think that's a really powerful way to start engaging in this space.
Thank you, Hannah. I think that's a really important point around what it takes to be an athlete and what it takes to save the climate, are some of the same mindsets. Barbara, so in the UK, a report was done by Albert, part of the BAFTA, and they analysed the number of times the words climate change were shown, were said in UK television, and the number of times climate change was said on UK television outside of news and current affairs, so in sports, in children's programmes, in drama. And climate change was mentioned on UK television less than zombies. And climate change was mentioned on UK television less than cake. That one I can live with. And less than cats. Sports feels like one of the TV categories, which actually are taking up that mantle and saying we should be talking about climate change outside of news and current affairs. It is relevant. Do you think that there's more that can be done for sport to really raise this debate, tell this story, and change that statistic so that climate change is being talked about more across different platforms?
I do. And I think it is absolutely essential that broadcasters do that. And there is actually a content pledge that's been made by 12 broadcasters, which is absolutely a commitment to tell more stories, to explore themes so our audiences understand more about climate change and therefore can make sustainable choices. But I think particularly in the sports sphere, it matters to our audience. It matters in particular to our younger audiences. If we are going to be a modern broadcaster and we are going to reflect events, we have to reflect them in the round. And I think this will be an increasing point of debate. I mean, frankly, go and look on the BBC Sport website and you will see this up front and centre. And it's partly because all of the stakeholders are also aware. We live in an era of interoperability. No one person is going to be able to do this on their own. It is a partnerships, it's collective effort, it's everybody joining forces and working together. And I do think the role of athletes is critical. You are extraordinary influencers, Nico as well. You are very, very powerful voices, and as broadcasters, we want to tell your story. And I think as we see more athletes step up, I think it just will become much more part of the conversation that we have around live events. We should not, though, forget the influence of our sports journalism, though. And I think one of the great things around the new target set is the annual reporting and the opportunity that is going to give journalists to hold this industry to account.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, very much. Lady, I'm going to come to you. Cammy and Rain very well put forward the intersection between the climate agenda and the justice agenda, climate justice. One thing which we know is that football especially has really lent in to some of the massive problems that it's had around overt racism, around social issues, around exclusion, with some success and with some challenges. Do you think that football especially is going to be able to take on the issues of the environment in the same way that some parts have faced into some of the really serious social justice issues?
I hope so. You know, I firmly believe that we're in a place now where athletes feel a lot freer to go out and voice their opinions. You know, for a long time, athletes were told to just be athletes, just concentrate on the job that they was doing and not really to get involved in other subjects. So, you know, as we've seen with Marcus Rashford and the great work he's recently just done, you know, it just goes to show, you know, how powerful our voices are and how they can be heard. So, you know, I'm hopeful that many more come out and, you know, really follow their dreams and what they believe in and really push the agenda on that. So, yeah, I do believe we're entering a phase where more and more athletes will come out and, you know, not be afraid to speak their mind.
Brilliant. I think that point about not being afraid to speak your mind is such a powerful call when you're dealing with issues like that. Thank you so much, Edley. Inga, what next? What needs to happen next, both in terms of production and in terms of that production footprint and in terms of that brain print? What are your hopes for where we keep going?
Just from a production footprint, I think we've talked about remote production a bit. I think virtual production is probably the next area where we can make massive leaps in reducing our carbon footprint. We've got a Sky News channel here, which is a completely virtual service. There's some people on the ground, but the gallery that we built back at base is not built from actual infrastructure, it's completely virtual. And I looked at it before coming here and just went, oh my God, the amount of energy that reduces is just incredible. So I think there's lots going on behind the scenes. I mean, I think on screen, the interesting is really, I think you've both just said it, it's been very much, we've not really leaned into, it's always been just about the sports. And I think we are all acknowledging much more. I think what you've also said is that sports is part of our culture. It's part of the joy of life. It's like really important. And therefore, it has a place to have a voice and to be able to talk about things that are not just about the performance, but that actually about the things that affect it, whether that is racism or sustainability. It's like, it's really important to take that stand. And I just don't think that we've done that much in the past. It's been very much, well, we're very professional talking about our sports. And now we acknowledge much more going, actually, it is all interconnected. And I think I really loved hearing that from you both, because I feel like that whole interconnectedness, we sometimes forget about it, even when we talk about climate change. It's very much like, well, there's us, and then there's the planet and the climate, and it's like, well, but it is all together. And so I truly feel like we're on a good path to step much further into that and use that power that we have.
Thank you very much. And I think that the idea to ask people to have so much passion about their sport, but not to allow that to spill over to other issues, seems really strange. It's just like, no, these are passionate people, driven people, people able to face into and push beyond what we think it's possible for a human to achieve. And could you not think of a better analogy for what we need to do on climate change than what sports people do every day, on that training, on that constantly finding the edge and finding it's possible to push beyond it? Rami and Rain, what do you hope? What do you hope you're going to hear and see from the entirety of the sports sector around the world, with who are carrying a significant footprint, but perhaps a much larger brain print on all of us and our cultures around the world? What would you hope to see in the future?
I would hope to see a recognition that sustaining any of the sport events that we currently have and celebrating that and uniting as really as a species behind that is going to hit sports first. I mean, let's think about the Australian Open and the fact that they had to stop for a significant amount of time because of the heat waves being experienced there. This is not something about like 10 years, 20 years from now. This is happening now. It's affecting ski racing. It's affecting one of the biggest, most famous ski races, actually, which happens in Austria. The race up on the Kitzsteinhorn in Kitzbühel. It's affecting it immediately, and it means that we have to realize that talking about sustainable, circular usage of resources within the sporting environment is really about sustaining sports. It's about sustaining that love that a significant amount of the world shares, and both within, kind of our European, more northern perspective, as well as in indigenous communities and ethnic communities that don't get highlighted as strongly by the media. Rain, do you want to add something to that?
Sure. I sort of want to echo some of Dudley's points that I really encourage the industry, both the participants, the industry, to have the moral courage to speak out. You know, the climate crisis necessitates a whole of society response. It's the story of our species, but sports is sort of the celebration of our species. And I think when you're looking at it in a holistic way, through sustainability, whether it's the creation of, you know, new venues, of materials, but also the heightened awareness of what, you know, these folks can do, like Nico, bringing that awareness to the forefront of preserving that hope in a very dark time, I think is absolutely indispensable, and is something that I really encourage the industry to continue to do and not plan for in the future, but do it right now. Thank you.
One comment I think is just to realize that sports is one of the few industries that combines inspiration, education, and then the technological reality of some of these sports, of race car driving, of even in the skiing area, space, and the whole supply chain behind that, and the entire industry. There are many other industries out there that should for sure get behind getting to net zero, but sports is one of the few that can also inspire at the same time. And so you have a real, real opportunity, if you're a trailblazer in that space, to bring everyone else with you, to bring the entire rest of the industries, to bring the planet with us on this journey.
Brilliant. Thank you so very much. We don't have any time. We could keep going. This, we're really digging into some really basics of mythology of sport and what it means to be a human being, and how sport is one of the things which brings us all together all around the world, much like climate change does. But we don't have any more time, so I'd like to thank Wayne, I'd like to thank Remy, I'd like to thank Inga, I'd like to thank Lily, I'd like to thank Barbara, and I'd like to, Hannah, would you just wait just for a moment? Thank you so very, very much for joining us on this panel. Thank you. And Hannah, do you just want to join me for a moment? Because we've had some amazing athletes up here on our stage. And I think that what we've come to in this conclusion is that, as well as the whole infrastructure of sport, as well as the competition, as well as the teamwork, which of course is such a core message, that so much of this comes down to the human, comes down to the person, comes down to that extraordinary ability that some of the wonderful sports people that we've had up here have to focus and to decide. And so we're about to hear from some of those athletes on what it takes to be a well-performing athlete and what it takes to solve climate change. So Hannah, would you like to introduce the film?
Yeah, absolutely. Post-Tokyo 2020, I was inspired by COP26 and wanted to unite as many global athletes, Olympians and Paralympians, to use their voice to try and encourage real ambition in this climate crisis fight. And this is the race we need to win. And thank you to the IOC for helping support this, and Melissa Wilson, who helped me put it together. This is our video.
Thank you so very much, everybody. Thank you for attending this group. Thank you.
Dear leaders of the world.
Dear leaders of the world.
Dear leaders of the world.
This summer, at the Tokyo Olympic and Paralympic Games,
we as athletes chased excellence in the face of challenges.
To overcome obstacles.
To lead the pack.
To go faster, higher, stronger.
Together.
Under immense pressure and adversity.
We delivered.
Meeting goals that others believe impossible.
Tokyo and the people of Japan delivered.
When many thought it impossible.
Each Games seeks to deliver a lasting legacy.
But how do we pass on that legacy if there isn't a safe and healthy planet to experience it?
Heat, humidity and extreme weather conditions
mean many of our sports are already under threat.
And sport is just one part of a much greater global picture.
We did our utmost this summer.
And we know that when we strive to achieve our best, others come with us.
Now, it's your chance to deliver.
This is the race we need to win.
And the speed of the race is determined by each of the participants in it.
At COP26,
the Olympics of climate summits,
we need you to lead us.
To show real ambition and courage.
Working together to secure the future that we all depend on.
Anything less won't win this race.
Over the next fortnight, we will be looking to you and supporting you.
To forge the ultimate legacy.
A healthy, safe Earth for all.
Yours, athletes of the world. Cheer team, to have what we're doing here. So I'm going to close by thanking you so very much for joining us today at this session. I want to thank particularly the UNFCCC Sports for Climate Action team, Lindita and others, for organising this. Can the UNFCCC team who have been working please wave so we can see you and give them a thank you? And of course, for all the work that's going to happen. And I did promise you we were going to do one more wave, so let's do it. We're starting here. Come on, let's go. Whoa! I'm back again. Whoa! That's the only UN panel you get to do that on. Thank you so very much.